Whether or not, even presidency or no presidency, we have to affect this economy in a way that all this mediocrity that has become part of us
can
go away. We should be running a 15 trillion naira budget, not a 8.6 trillion naira budget, which you want to do next year. I've never seen why an economy will be, you know, in an instance where you have 3.2% growth rate in population alone. You have 9.1 trillion this year. You're budgeting 8.6 trillion next year. In real terms, when you consider inflation, that is 7.5 trillion naira. And, you know, that means that you're precipitating another recession. And let me shock you, sir. You know, 1983, the budget for this economy was $20.5 billion.
I heard you talk about that. When you compare back to naira, apparently we've not grown. In fact, as you were saying,
1983,
going down to 1983,
1983 was 26 billion
in dollar tax. Exactly.
And today, can it you beat is that? 25 billion.
Billion. So we're really not moving.
In fact, the Oyo State allocation was $25 million as of 1983. That was 25 million naira. Because it was one to one then. Because the whole currency of Nigeria went kaput in 1986. When the new currency regime came on the 26th of January 1986, $25 million then was is 9 billion naira in today's money. And guess what? Or your state monthly allocation now is 4 billion.
It's no,
so we are lost 5 billion
now. Now look at the growth of population, for example.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a country like a car in reverse. And then you're going at like 180 kilometers per hour.
Telling me the way the managers are thinking. Okay, let's come to you. What are your policies, trade policy as far as Nigeria is concerned? Things you will be doing because, I mean, looking at China being able to leave hundreds of millions of poverty because of their growth on export. Mm-hmm. Shipping almost becoming the factory of the world, as it were. So what exactly? I have a couple of other things to talk about. I know time will not permit to both
of import and export. Right?
Yeah.
So what's my policy? Let's say on export alone. I mean, it's so problematic exporting anything out of Nigeria now.
Yeah.
It's always been getting much more and more
difficult.
It's getting worse. It's easier to clear goods on import than to export anything out of this country.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, I'm also seeing a scenario where our exporters are incurring losses. That I'm talking to you, there are people who sent dried fish to America and they're emptying all of those dried fish inside the Atlantic. Before then, it was yam last year or early this year, which were emptied into the Atlantic.
Cash,
I also read about even beans, the one that was banned from European Union, they extended that ban by 2 years.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, come on. So we have a big problem on the export end. You know, so one of the things we should certainly reduce export tariff. Let's not even think about it. Encourage those guys who are struggling to export anything out of this country. Number two, we have to look into the area of logistics for clearing those things out of this country. The export
expansion grant.
Let me tell you something, sir. Someone told me the other day the way they do it in China, that for China, okay, and you want to come and sell it back here at maybe 12 naira. Somebody can buy that same thing. A Chinese person can buy that same thing at 10 naira and come and sell at 9 naira here because for everything they export, they get
a certain so they are competitive.
No, you understand? They get a certain subsidy from their government.
For exporting.
Which will feel about 15%. Meaning, you know, outside this country, 15% is a lot of interest rate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So you will never be able to compete with that China person. You know what I mean? So these are the kind of things I'm thinking on the export end, you know. However, also, I'm very much interested in value addition on export.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
So, the other time I did a research around the solid mineral industry and things that we sell and all of that. For example, there's something called coltan. Which you probably know, a guru in that area. Columbine tantalite, you know. This tantalite it goes into every phone as a capacitor, right? The columbine also goes into the phone around this area. I also studied barite, all right? A friend of mine sent me something on LinkedIn. That barite is used as a drilling mud.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that, you know, it took so much effort by the NCDMB, that is the Nigeria Local Content, you know, for the IOCs to buy our own barite.
Mm-hmm.
How can we have barite here and then you go and import your barite from abroad?
And they complain of quality, but I think that's a problem that can be fixed.
If we were a normal country, we will force them to do something about that quality. Whatever it takes, whatever industry, whatever science it takes. Quid pro quo. Call the CEOs and say, okay, listen, you have a problem with the quality of our barite. Okay, what can we do together? Now, look, because you cannot be throwing money outside. And mean, here we are. Okay, for example, I was discussing with you on gas, right? You know, every ounce, every liter of gas, all right, okay, that is used in the houses, the LNG in this country, from what I read from the guys that are in charge of gas in NNPC, is imported. Every LNG. And every LNG that we manufacture is exported. Imagine. You know, according to, there's a guy called that, you know, and this is a major problem for us, you know. So I would be very much interested in adding value to export on import.
Okay.
On import, you see.
No, let me say something about that import. Yeah, I wanted to make a comment around this. CBN had an issue with 41 item, I don't know if you're aware of it, that were restricted such that you can't have access to foreign exchange on those items. Because, and that will happen during the recession, because we can produce those things locally. It's been a challenge for a number of people in that space. So as you talk about import, I want to talk about that.
Hey, I will look at that, because the point is also that I have a certain kind of bias, you know, whereas, you know, these days, you know, you cannot have restrictive policies. If you are going to have restrictive policies, you have to be very smart about it. You sign up a couple of things in the World Trade Organization.
Yeah,
you
yeah. Those are the issues. You know, WTO is raising.
And someone also said that look, when you restrict import, you are not promoting exports. You know, I read something like that. Look, the more you restrict import, the more the other
anyway. No, number one, they're not saying the
No. I would rather go down.
Okay,
the tariff.
Increasing the tariff on it.
Increase tariff.
Discourage.
The US does that. You can find. So look, US has they have tariffs on steel. They have on these. They're protecting that industry and all of that. You can play the game. You know, but in terms of banning outright, you know, or restricting from forex, you're just putting. More
because those things are still coming in.
Exactly.
They're still coming in. Yes. Coming
but you're saying that, look, which reminds me, that instance reminds me of the total mismanage of Nigeria's foreign exchange by this present government sometime in 2016 or so, when they allowed the Naira to run as low as 520 to the dollar. It was so reckless, and that was what deepened the recession in this country. Mm-hmm. It was extremely reckless because what they did was something called price discovery, all right, in finance. And what they did was, you know, when you say, when a certain president comes out and says, well, if you want to treat yourself abroad and health and all of that, I don't care, you did go and source your money anyway. That's reckless. Any rate to take that guy to India,
yeah,
that is price discovery. So the moment you know that someone will say, okay, well, government says you should sell dollar at 305, but there's someone there who's willing to buy at 800, price discovery. Someone said, okay, there's an indicative rate of 800 there. Let's hold on to our money because it seems like this is going to 800. A mother, let me give you another analogy. A mother who has a daughter in Ukraine, in the cold, or in Russia, studying medicine, 1 year to go. You tell her to go and withdraw her daughter. Like, are you kidding yourself?
It's not going to be buy at any price.
Look, the moment if the child calls her and says, look, they've thrown me out of well, I'm in the cold right now, I'm shivering, nowhere to stay, I don't have food to eat.
You will look for money anyway.
Oh, I want to go and do prostitution, maybe I can find money. She will buy dollar at 1,000 naira. She will sell everything she has.
Okay, you know?
So Jonathan may have killed the economy. Buhari has come to bury the economy. That's what he has done.
Now, okay, what's your take on the African Continental Free Trade Agreement?
I would sign for it immediately. Nigeria should be leading the charge on the AFCTA, whatever it's they call it.
Yeah,
African,
yeah.
You know, trader. For crying out loud. The kind of arguments that I've heard from people, including the so-called manufacturer
is absolutely
nonsensical.
It's very primitive.
You say that we cannot join a trade in this continent. We cannot compete with Guinea-Bissau and Ghana.
What's
because you say you don't have
what's interesting to me is that EPA, we say we are not interested.
Exactly.
That's Europe.
Exactly.
Are you not afraid of fellow Africans?
My brother, that's
fellow,
the point.
Fellow Africans.
That's exactly my take. Look,
fellow Africans.
We should be leading the charge on trading. Now, listen, whatever it takes, and you know what, let me tell you, fellow Nigerians, this is the reason why you guys have to vote for someone different from the same old people who have laid our economy to waste and made your life so miserable. These guys cannot think, all right? They're not ready to do the important stuff to get us. Listen, there's something, sometimes you have to go through the shock therapy. What is the big deal in organizing ourselves under a couple of years to ensure Africa?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, the other day, Garba Shehu came out and said there was going to be drought. That was in 2017. Or so, you know, that there was going to be drought because 500 trucks of grains leave northern Nigeria for Niger, up to Mali, go to wherever, you know. And, be, and the, what I saw from that is, okay, fine, it is trade. But do the export proceeds come back? Can someone use that to do money laundering and move money out?
You can.
Go to the north and, you know, finance a few of these things, take the money out, it's sold out there, you take your money, move it to wherever you want to move it. And then you say you have terrorism problem.
So the point is that
I believe that more than anything, that would have been a great opportunity for us to document trade properly in Africa. So import policy for me, I don't quite believe in import substitution the way they are doing it now.
So how would you do it differently?
I would actually target some imports, you know, maybe once, and then again it's going to be tariff based.
Okay.
For me, it's going to be tariff. But I would say that the agri policy is wrong at that, because you don't take only one product. I get very exactly what I'm saying. Listen, if I'm going
that's exactly what facing us in oil. Look at the price of oil and the price of oil is doing. That's exactly. So if you focus on one product,
I'm going to tell you two things right now.
Yeah.
The first thing is, you know, I'm going to tell you something about oil. But the first thing is that, number one, Nigeria is doing very well in sorghum, in millet. Well, in all of this that I'm mentioning, we're first to top five
in the world. Yeah.
You know, sorghum, millet, yam, cassava, okra.
Yeah.
Which other one? You're the guru. You tell me. You know what I mean? But look, the government has not done any incentive in these areas.
So they are heavily traded around the world.
Heavily traded. Including heavily this traded. Thing that they sprinkle on bread. What's it called?
Sesame seed.
You know what I mean? You know, the French like that thing a lot. You know, everything comes with sesame on them and all that stuff. Are we assisting the farmers in those areas? Why are we focused on rice? You know, why are we not also maintaining? Before you know it, we're going to lose our position on all of this. Look at palm oil.
I saw data on palm oil.
My brother.
That palm oil. The palm oil is more expensive than crude.
Which is true. The last time I bought palm oil, yes.
It is.
My brother, palm oil is more expensive than crude oil.
Yeah.
The last time I bought palm oil, I was going from Akure back to Abuja, you know, around the Ogbese area to Owo, you know, see those guys. It's about 2,500 naira for 4 liters, you know, which tells about 625 naira for 1 liter of palm oil.
Shall I even tell you the big joker now?
Yes, sir.
The big joker now, melon.
Egusi
is a 6.7 billion.
That's why we're here. Melon. So that you know, I've always told people, my own is I'm here to torpedo the thinking of people. You know,
melon.
That's
true. A lot of your colleagues, really. That, I mean, talking about the idea dropping now, I'm not seeing
and most of them don't have ideas.
I'm not seeing those ideas on how to grow this economy.
Most of them don't have ideas.
And then help us to make a lot of money.
Look, if you call them to this your show, they won't come.
Why? Because I'm very cerebral.
You know, they know you now. You headed expert in that money. You did this thing. I've listened to you in class. I know that even when you called me, I had to do some research. This guy, let him come and disgrace me on national radio. But the point is, you know, so please, that thing about oil, this is a calculation. Barrel of crude oil, as we're speaking today, about $60.
Right.
Multiplied by 305 naira is 18,300 naira. So I now say, what exactly is the price of 1 liter of crude? Now, one barrel contains 159 barrels. I mean, liters. Divide it, I found 115 naira. And 1 liter of palm oil on the road is 625.
Yeah.
Now, and I now went and looked for the price of palm oil on the global market. That I'm talking to you is about $540 per ton.
Yeah.
A ton is about 1,000 kg. You know, and I looked at the density of palm oil is different from water.
Yeah,
so it was 0.93 or thereabout to the water at one. You know, meaning that at the end of when I looked at it,
Why did
Malaysia and Indonesia focus on palm oil? We have bought a dud in this country. That crude oil is nothing. You know, Malaysia and Indonesia, they are producing 25 times what we are producing in Nigeria individually. If you add the two of them together, they are producing 50 times, and they got the seeds from here.
So ahead.
Listen, not only that, they've created the palm oil futures market.
Yeah.
The futures market, they're trading it. I believe that that's the reason why we are here. so that at least we can help our country.
I love the energy which he has.
No, listen. And the passion. Posting, you know what I mean?
Unfortunately, time is now our friend.
Are you kidding me? I'm just warming up. Many things that we need to talk about. You know, so let me say this very quickly. Number one, the things we must do to diversify this economy. Number one, of course, you are Greek, but I believe that we must put a lot more science in agri, value add, and also to ensure that we put, you know, all the product of research and all of that in there. Number two, of course, we have to secure ourselves. Very important, because without security, this won't work. Again, on security, I believe that we can employ a lot more youth into that sector. And I don't see anything wrong in public sector. I don't even believe that we don't have a public sector in Nigeria. We're not taking care of our people, our most vulnerable people. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And until we understand the idea,
so how much you pay workers?
No, listen. Right now, the workers, the minimum wage right now, if you want to maintain 2010 standard, is 45,000 naira.
Okay.
If they agree with me on 30,000, I will use that. But I will ensure that all of this waste in government is reduced. Number three, tidy up your environment. The environment can employ at least 3 million people sustainably in this country. We need to be finicky about our environment. We need to be obsessed about the environment. Number four, you know. Clothe yourself. The textile sector must be repositioned. In Rwanda now, they increase the tariff on used clothes from 20 cents to $2.50.
Yeah, yeah. And
we should be doing that. Number five, okay. House yourselves. We haven't started. The housing sector is a growth area, okay. But not all of these luxury houses that they built all over the place that nobody is living in. More than 3 million houses, luxury houses are unoccupied in this country.
Okay, thank you very much for coming. My name is Mendela.
Next time, give me 3 hours.
We give you 3 hours to be able to talk. Okay. See you next week and bye for now. Okay,
according to NBC standard, we normally put a disclaimer out there. The opinions shared on any political platform here are totally the opinion of the speaker.
Another
inspiration. I agree. They are my opinions, please, Nigerians. Anywhere you see the computer logo, that is we. Vote for the computer party, everybody, Senate, House of Rep, House of Assembly.
Thank you so much.
Computer party.
All right, thank you. That's it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.